Tell me a little bit about your management style. You said that you have implemented Agile.
Yeah.
How far are you with that? And in general, what is your style of creating and growing your teams?
Yeah. Now, the first thing is that I really believe that the people know more than I am. Mm-hmm. I try to get a lot of smart people around me. I think if you do that, then you automatically start to listen a lot. So I try to listen a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, when I conclude it and have the vision and we discuss that, then I start communicating that.
Yeah.
But I think the first step is that I listen a lot. Mm-hmm. So by that, they also, I'm a manager that's really approachable.
So people are important for you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's definitely the case. Yeah, I think although we are in an IT business,
mm-hmm.
actually we're not. We're in a people's business. I mean, people can make computers do what we want.
Yeah.
But if you are, if they are not the right people, then forget it.
Okay. And what is your style to, let's say, motivate people to make sure that your teams excel, that they go the extra mile?
It's first, I try to spend time with them.
Mm-hmm.
So I try to visit day starts. I try to actually, in Agile, we call it impediments. So I try to clear impediments for them. I don't tell them what they should do.
Mm-hmm.
I try to make sure they can work in the best way.
Yep.
It's a little bit about my daughter. I cannot tell her to study. I can only create the circumstances in which she can excel. So actually my role is to create the circumstances that the teams can excel, the people can excel.
Okay. So Ilko, let's talk about leadership as well.
Yes.
What kind of leader are you? And what do you think people say about you when you're not around?
Joke is always ask them. We're going to meet maybe some of them later.
Okay, I'll ask them.
I think that I'm approachable. I think they will say that I have a long-term vision.
Mm-hmm.
That I have a long-term view for IT and for the company. I think they also say that I can be sometimes a little bit more practical. Those are the important things.
Okay. Yeah. And how do you build leadership in your teams? Because that's key, of course.
Yes. I think important for my team is that there's nobody's perfect. So important for my team is that we have a balanced team. So mm-hmm. we have people who are more good in the details, in the structure. We have people who are more thinkers or dreamers. We need people who are really content specialists. So that's how I build my team.
Yep.
And by spending time together, I think we are a global team. So my direct management team is sitting in different regions as well.
Yep.
But still, we try to spend time together. And not only on the content, but also just to get to know each other. Because in the end, we have to together do it.
So you need to travel a lot then? Or?
Yes, yes. Although we have sustainability is a great thing with ABN AMRO nowadays. So we have really good video conferences. We have all the facilities are there to not to travel.
Okay.
But then again, it's
still important to meet and
to touch each other and to smell, touch, feel each other. And so I do that.
Yeah.
And then it's also easier to do it over video afterwards.
Ilko, let's talk a bit more about yourself.
Yes.
About you as a personality. What is it that drives you in your work? When you stand up in the morning and say, yes, I can go to my bank.
Yeah. Usually, I'm an early morning person, so I really am usually quite happy when I stand up. I think it's multiple things. Our business is really complex.
Mm-hmm.
So I love the complexity. So the challenges and the problems that come with that, I love to attack them and get them. And the other part is the fun and the people.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's, I could not work in a kind of an isolated, sometimes I also need my quietness,
mm-hmm.
but I love being in meetings all day, meeting people all day long, listen to them, learn from them. I'm quite a curious person.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, for me, it's, this afternoon I have a meeting about a new platform we are probably gonna acquire. I love that. Oh yeah, let's discuss that.
So you like change, you like new things?
Yeah, yes, definitely. That's that's what makes me drive. So I'm not the one you should hire when you want to make sure your business keeps on running.
Okay. So we've in this series we use the not necessarily scientific but still used a lot MBTI personality profiling.
Yeah.
And you have shared with us that you are an ENFP.
Yes.
Extrovert, intuitive, feeling, perceptive.
Yeah.
Profile that's also called the campaigner. People with this profile, personality profile, they're curious, observant, energetic, enthusiasts, they're excellent communicators, they know how to relax, and they're popular and friendly. How does that resonate with you?
Good. I agree. Easy. But you're probably now going to say there are also some challenges with
that. There's some development areas for development some people areas, as well. Yes. So people with this personality profile sometimes have poor practical skills, difficulties to focus, they can overthink things, can get stressed easily, and they're sometimes too emotional.
Yeah.
So which of these things resonate with you, and how did you overcome these then?
They all resonate with me. At least I all recognize them. Yeah. I think there are different ways how I overcome them.
Mm-hmm.
First, my team.
Mm-hmm.
I think I believe that you can work on certain areas, like development points, but it's never going to be your strength. So you can keep on focusing on them, but some of those things, when I was 25, I had them, mm-hmm. and now I'm 45, they're still there.
Yeah.
Of course, you develop them, but so you need to have people around you to do that.
So you need to complement your weaknesses with the right team around yourself.
And I definitely have some people in my current team that are really, wow, I cannot do it without them because they really complement me in that way. The other part, of course, you have to develop them. If you grow up, you grow in the ranks,
mm-hmm.
you have to make sure that also your weak points are growing with you.
Yeah.
And I think also the role requires things. So when I was a consultant, it was more easy because a lot of the things you mentioned as a campaigner were very good for a consultant.
Yeah.
But are not always helpful as a senior manager.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't look at the scores, but I did it before, and I saw that my scores also changing a little bit because different things are expected from you because you have to keep the show on the road.
Yeah.
So not caring about details or not focusing, that's not an option.
Yeah.
Because you can just not do that.
Yeah. So how do you force yourself to focus on things? Do you have specific methods for that? Or?
Work from home is an important thing because there you really can have to focus. Make sure my team challenges me on that.
Mm-hmm.
So Ilko, did you really read that and what you really mean with that? I think those are two important things to do that. And the other thing is just doing it.
You have a potential challenge that you get stressed, like everybody has a big jump, you can get stressed. So how do you deal with your stress? How do you make sure that you relax and get grounded again?
Yeah, well, luckily, I think one of the things I didn't recognize too much is the stress.
Okay.
Although I also have stress, let's be honest. Mm-hmm. I think if you run a business like this, you sometimes have to live a little bit on adrenaline or on stress. Eh?
An engine of a flying plane,
that's kind of
it comes with a bit of stress.
Although you planned it really, really well, there's still some stress.
Yeah.
I try to finish my work at work. I used to try to come home at a decent time, and then, you know what, at night I work a little bit, but I try to stop that and make sure that I make maybe a little bit longer day in the office,
mm-hmm.
I'm in the office, and then when I'm done, I'm done. It's difficult because we have an international business, so all the time somebody's wreck.
Conference calls in the evening or early in the morning.
But that's the starting point. The other part is I'm also good in letting go. I'm not an. I think I. When I'm on holiday, I can easily let go.
Yeah.
And I can really be irritated when they try to reach me for something. Well, other people, they love it.
Yeah.
But I can easily go, no way.
And you do sports?
I do sports, yeah. I think my favorite is cycling.
Mm-hmm.
I do both the road cycling and the mountain biking.
Okay.
Winter is more mountain biking, summer is more road cycling. But also with different purposes. With the mountain biking, you go on the single tracks with the curves and the jumps. You cannot think about anything else than like skiing.
You need to focus on
the focus, the next second.
The moment, yeah,
otherwise you're gone. So that's to clear your head. The road cycling, long roads, you can think and reflect on things.
Yep.
So so sometimes I also have to think about something, mm-hmm. I go road cycling.
Okay. You have a family, you have a 9-year-old daughter,
yes.
I understand.
Yeah.
What are the values that you want to give to your daughter?
Yeah, I actually realized I'm quite Calvinistic.
Uh-huh.
So meaning...
What does that mean?
it starts with just work hard. So the saying, when the brilliant idea, it's mostly just hard work. So when I when you talk to people or read biographies, it's a lot about just work and dedicate, commit, focus.
Yeah.
And then maybe you have some luck as well. But that's a starting point.
Yeah.
I don't believe in the idea that, no, I'm brilliant, so I don't have to, I'm not, so I have to really do it from hard work. So I think one of the values I try to give is, okay, it all starts with the effort you put in, the effort you get out. That's one. I think the other one is integrity and how you treat people.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's important. I think with everything you do, you should think about, okay, how does it help other people? Do I not harm other people with this? We sometimes have the saying in the company also, if it ends up at the front of the newspaper, could you explain it? Is it okay with your values?
Mm-hmm.
And if that's the case, that's a good kind of test.
Okay. So if you're very much value-driven then. That is, it's important to be authentic, to be open, to be social with the team, make sure that everybody comes along and you don't lose anybody.
Yes, although I learned also, maybe the hard way, that you're also expected to be a manager. At a certain moment, it's you.
You have to make tough decisions.
You have to make the decision. And it's interesting because my team it's good as a diverse team, multicultural.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes when we have discussions with my team, there are some Dutch managers in there who love to discuss and discuss and discuss and try to get a compromise.
Uh-huh.
While my American guy, the CEO of the US, say, make a decision. Come on. I don't care. We follow you. You make a decision and we go for it. While the Dutch people say, no way, no way.
Let's first look at all the different options and study it and make a sub-commission.
And then we say yes, and then that means that we start now. And the British are again different. So that's again a very interesting aspect of my role.
I can imagine,
but also very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
But indeed, you have to make the tough decisions then.
Okay. Do you have a personal mantra or some guiding principles that you live by?
And there's this Dalai Lama saying, and he says something like, it's your mind that creates this world. Meaning it's how you look at things that creates this world. So part of that is don't. Yeah, I think one of my MBTI was the not judging, the
perceiving.
I try to keep the judging out of it as long as possible, to keep an open mind.
Mm-hmm.
It's also how you look at problems. Your mind is immediately looking at, a problem, help, what am I going to do? Or is it all the mind power? Because you have limited processing power.
Yeah.
So the moment you don't, you get self-distracted by have to get an opinion or stress out. No, focus on the problem.
Okay.
And it also brings it to yourself. Because it's your mind. Circumstances you can change, but they are there. But you can only change the way you look at it and what you do with it.
Okay. You're triggered by Buddhism. I mean, you mentioned Dalai Lama.
Yeah.
What does that learn you?
It learns the non-judging part.
Mm-hmm.
It learns to stand still for a moment sometimes,
mm-hmm.
to not be energetic all the time, but sit down and breathe and relax. It learns you that all people are equal.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning, if you are a senior manager, you are a CEO, you are whoever you are, we're all just people.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to treat each other with respect.
Yeah. In your life, who are the people that you look up to?
Yeah.
The mentors, people that you admire, and what did you learn from them?
Yeah. I think one is the Dalai Lama, I have to say. I think that goes for many people. And other people, I think I never had one person to look up to. There are different people I take part from. Hey, Johan Cruyff, the famous Dutch football player, of course. His simple logic. I think maybe you remember in high school there were math teachers who could explain something in 4 sentences and you would understand it. And others need half an hour and you still didn't have it. Johan Cruyff was really, but you need really knowledge for that. If you really understand it, you can explain it simple. There's also the saying, I didn't have time to write you a short letter, so I write you a long letter. And Johan Cruyff, so I admire him from that to really be...
And he said every advantage has its disadvantage.
Yeah, and what is so true?
How did he say it?
Like
Voordeel heb scenario.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. And that's so true. And you see, it's so people use it so often now because it's
the great Dutch philosopher.
So it's yeah. I think with Abe Rombo, Gert Salem was one of those. Not because of all the things, but he was able to write, and I'm not even possible because, but I'm not even capable of doing that. While he is much more busy than I was, he wrote a blog every day. Every day,
wow.
At his kitchen table at night, he was writing this piece of paper and just about his day. Of course, you couldn't write everything, but you wrote it. I did this, I made that, and he called highlighted people from the company he met. Every day, for all his time within Abe Rombo. That you have, and he used Twitter before there was Twitter, maybe.
So he was like, take time every day to reflect on what you did today.
Yeah, and share it with all staff.
Yep.
And I found
was a public blog as well.
Yeah. So I found that was great. Mm-hmm. Yeah. When I grew up in the 80s, so people like Jack Welch, the GE. I think we now look at it differently, but there was a hero then.
So Ilko, how far do you think that automation and let's say automation in the finance environment, how far will that go in the future?
It goes much farther than we will see nowadays. We see some examples of still people doing things that can be automated, to be honest. And I think we have to realize that everything people do nowadays can be automated. You see it in law firms, in financial firms, in all kind of firms. When I have a discussion with my GP, my huisarts, I tell her, you can be automated soon because Google knows it better. Why? How much? And then I had something and she Googled it. I said, I could have done that. Yeah, but this is kind of a closed Google, especially for doctors. So, no. So, but also in our company, I believe that actually operations is everything we do before it's getting automated.
Okay.
That doesn't mean we don't need operation anymore, eh? Because we still will have fallouts. Because if you automate it, still things can go wrong.
Yeah.
So we need people who analyze that, who look the root causes. When we have new products and services, we first have to learn the manual before we can automate them. That's a second group. And of course, we have to control the processes.
Yep.
So we have to get the data out of there, we have the MI. So I'm not saying operations will go away, but it will definitely completely change the way we do things.
Okay. Now, you've been global CIO here for 5 years.
Yes.
You had your successes. I'm sure that in this or in previous jobs, you also had some brilliant failures.
Yes.
Could you share your most brilliant failure ever and what did you learn from it?
One only, right?
Yeah, one is fine.
I think at this moment I'm in a really big outsourcing.
Yeah.
The infrastructure we outsource to an external company.
Yeah.
And actually from a strategy point of view, it really makes sense. In my consulting years, I've been an outsourcing consultant. So I've been advising CEOs of big companies about really deals of tens of millions on outsourcing. And now I'm CEO myself, and I'm making not every mistake in the book, but a lot of things I've said to the then CEOs, to my clients at that time, I'm making those mistakes.
Okay.
That's
Can you give an example?
For example, how to set up your governance.
Uh-huh.
Really strict governance, really a lot of KPIs around it. Really make sure the right meeting structure is there. Make sure that on your own side you have enough people to manage that. Don't make it too small. And what we did, we made a governance organization too small. So we cannot really completely control the vendor to the level we like to.
Okay.
Same goes for the knowledge you keep in house. Keep in house.
Yep.
You want to keep your key knowledge also in house, so you can challenge the vendor.
No.
We gave too much knowledge away.
Okay.
So we're now building it up again. It will be okay, it is okay.
Yeah.
But those things I almost can hear and myself telling to my clients those days, and I do them myself. And that is really frustrating. So I nowadays I don't dare to say anymore that I used to be an outsourcing consultant.
So in your life, did you have things that, did you have major setbacks in your life that, that you learned from? I mean, you've built a successful life, but I'm sure there were things in your life where it didn't go right as well.
I think I've been almost quite fortunate in my life. I think the big thing, my father passed away when I was 18 years old. And that's quite of a coming of age type of period. He was sick for 5 years, he was ill for five years, so it was quite a long time. And those are the years you kind of want to put your parents away. While at this moment, you cannot do that because, so that was...
That was tough.
That was tough, yeah. That was kind of a difficult period. Although in light of my mantra, it's how you look at it. I decided quite quickly to make the best out of it. A little bit also now, the worst that can happen to me has happened. It cannot get any worse than this. And it was still quite okay.
But did that mean that you had to mature quicker than normally? You had to be in more independent quicker than people of the same age?
Yes, definitely. I had a mother and two, half a mother and two younger sisters. And of course it gives you some responsibility. And some, although my mother did a great job in there, of course it makes you older, makes you more responsible. I never realized that until I think it was only 10 years ago or so. A friend of me told me, yeah, but of course you were there, and he was kind of explaining to me, and oh really, I never thought of that like that. So there was
quite noble for you.
Even of course you had that background that it happened, so you were more mature than us. Really?
So people that watch these conversations, some of them have the ambition to become global CIO of a bank or an important digital leader in the future. What would your advice be to your, let's say, your younger self 10 years ago or people that are that are management consultant today and want to grow up as a CIO? What's your advice to them?
Work hard. It's a lot to do about luck, because my role also, of course, you have to have the talents and you have to have, but it also comes at a certain moment, you have to kind of make sure the luck comes your way. And that's one. I think also be good at something. It's always good, I think, to have something that you really, what is your strength. So in the first years, really try to be the best developer there is, be the best consultant there is. Be the best architecture. So you have to really, and even if more specific, be the best Python developer there is. So really to make sure that you have always something that, that you can fall back on. And you can also, when you're chosen, you're chosen for that. Another thing also, study. It's a knowledge economy. So although all knowledge is available, it's too much knowledge. So you really have to pick your areas. So, and I don't wait too long with that. So I think 5 to 10 years max after you finish your university or high school, you really have to make sure you pick up another study again in a little bit of a different area, of course.
Okay, very good advice. Thank you for that. So is there anything else you wanted to share in this interview? That you say, well, this is really what I would like to share with the world, things that in my life, in my job, that that I think are important.
First, thank you for having me here. I think it was really nice. I really enjoyed. I think the other part is, you said you stand up in the morning every day happy. Of course, I'm not standing up every day happy. But you have to make it happy. I have this saying, do not always do the things you like, but like the things you do. So when you just do the things with conviction and with passion, you will like them. Sometimes I also have to clean the house, what is not my favorite hobby. But when you do it with proud and compassion and compassion and passion, it will become a nice thing to do. It will, you will enjoy it. So, and I think if you take that to your life and to your work, this is great.
And on that note, thank you very much, Ilko. It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you.